Over the past two decades, the size of Africa's economy has grown more than 50%, double the world average. But how are those economic benefits shared among the population? And what does this mean for social mobility over generations? My name is Rasman Widraugo. I'm an economist trying to fill in the data gaps to find out if this generation of Africans is better off than the ones before it. I come from Burkina Faso, from a family of non-educated farmers. I was sent to school and now earn a living as an economist for the IMF. And I am not alone. A lot of people are able to earn more income, go to a better school, or generally take advantage of more opportunities than their parents. This is what economists call social mobility. To measure social mobility, economists usually compare parent income data to those of their children. The problem in Africa is that those joint income data for parents and their children are missing. And there are not many studies on social mobility. So if you want to understand social mobility in Africa, how do we fill in the gaps? We have used education and occupational status of parents and children as a proxy of the standard of living. Using the information for 70 million people from 28 African countries, reaching back as far as 100 years, we came to three findings. First, in Africa, economic opportunities in terms of educational attainment have improved over time. Africans born in the mid-90s from uneducated parents have a 60% likelihood of completing at least primary school compared to the mid-40s when that rate was only 20%. However, in terms of occupational attainment, the picture is more gloomy. 80% of children whose parents work in traditional, low-skilled agricultural jobs are likely to follow in their parents' footsteps. If you put these facts together, it shows us that while educational mobility has improved, occupational mobility remains low. In short, this increased educational level has not translated into better jobs for a lot of people working their family farm. Our second finding was that it matters where you are born. There are huge disparities between countries and within countries. For example, in Botswana and South Africa, 75% of children achieve a higher level of education than their parents. But in Ethiopia and Mozambique, this rate is lower than 30%. In terms of occupational status, in Botswana and South Africa, 50% have a higher job status than their former parents, but in Ethiopia and Mozambique, fewer than 5% have better jobs. There is also a huge rural-urban divide, with people living in cities having better educational and occupational opportunities. The gender gap, while substantial in the 40s, has been narrowing over recent years. And the third finding was, despite the educational gains in recent decades, the upward job mobility of educated people has declined among younger Africans. In fact, the chances for well-educated individuals of getting a better job than the previous generations have declined since the 20s. So where is the disconnect between education and occupation? Why is not educational mobility becoming occupational mobility? It is linked to two factors. There are a higher number of graduates, but the job market is not growing to meet them. These graduates are also facing a mismatch between what the market needs and their skills. And that comes down to policy and market failures. Upward mobility seems to be positively associated with access to infrastructure, stability, and social spendings. Countries with higher level of public education spending, more social protection, and better infrastructure quality tend to have higher rate of social mobility. On the other hand, countries affected by conflict and those rich in natural resources tend to have lower mobility. So knowing the data trends and the social gaps they point to, how can Africa better take advantage of its educational progress? First, targeted policies to tackle the rural-urban divide, narrow the gender gap, and shrink regional inequalities are essential. Sustaining education spending and investing in human physical capital will be critical to bridge the existing gaps and create and share opportunities with all citizens. Second, investing in basic infrastructure could enhance education and employment and help lift households out of poverty. Third, good governance and social policies can create educational and employment opportunities for children. African countries should therefore promote good governance and enact policies aiming to extend social protection coverage and reduce the risk of violent conflict. There is an African proverb that says, we desire to give two things to our children. The first one is roots, the other is wings. That is why we need prompt and appropriate actions to ensure that these roots and wings are in place for better economic and social opportunities and a bright future for African children.